Welcome back to campus. You guys look very professional. Very proud of you guys today. This is one of my favorite career services events because it's really an opportunity for you to sit kind of anonymously in an audience and ask these folks who really get involved in the hiring process in their school districts and agencies questions that you might not feel uncomfortable asking anybody else. It's kind of that situation where you can really ask things like, you know, well, where do I find out salary information, for example, in your district? Or what do you, you know, what kind of questions should I absolutely know the answer to when I'm interviewing with you? So it's a really great opportunity to ask those kinds of things. I have the great honor of introducing each of our four panelists right now, and I'm actually going to start at the far end with George Ferro. George is completing his 11th year as principal of the Whitman Middle School in the Whitman-Hanson Regional School District. Previously, he served as assistant principal in Westport, Mass., and was a teacher in the New Bedford school system. In 2009, he was named Massachusetts Principal of the Year by MetLife. George. George is currently on the board of directors for the Massachusetts Secondary School Administrators Association and holds the position of second vice president. He is a 1993 and 1990 grad of Bridgewater State University. So I imagine it was Bridgewater State College back then, George.
It right? Certainly was.
Yeah, me too, back then. Welcome back, George.
Thank you.
And then to George's left is, second left, is Ian Kelly. Ian is currently the principal of the Bennett Hemingway Elementary School in Natick, Mass. Prior to his tenure in Natick, Ian serves as a classroom teacher, Title I director, and assistant principal. So you've seen it from all ends, Ian. That's great. Ian received his bachelor's from Frostburg State University in Maryland, two master's degrees from Cambridge College, and is currently a doctoral student at the Boston College Lynch School of Education, focusing on educational leadership. And to Ian's left is Ryan Powers. Ryan taught at the sixth grade classroom in Wrentham, Mass. For 8 years. After that, he served as assistant principal at the Angelo Elementary School in Brockton for 3 years, and then was promoted to principal for 4 years. Currently, Ryan is in his third year as the principal of the Mary E. Baker Elementary School, also in Brockton. And we know Ryan very well because the Mary Baker School is a professional development school for Bridgewater State University. I think this is our second year in that partnership? First year, yeah. So a lot of students spend a lot of time at the Baker School, and we've been really grateful to the staff for welcoming them. All right, and now, last but not least, Amanda Preston. Hi, Amanda. Sorry you're last here on the list. Amanda is the Senior Management of Recruitment for the Office of Human Capital in the Boston Public Schools, where she oversees recruitment systems and policies. Amanda started as a grad analyst in 2011 and moved to the role of Engagement Facilitator and then Network Liaison for the Office of Family and Student Engagement. Prior to her work at Boston Public Schools, Amanda ran youth programming at the Community Center in Dorchester after returning from teaching with an arts outreach program in Cape Town, South Africa. Amanda holds a master's in urban education policy from Brown University and a bachelor's degree in English literature from Bryn Mawr College. So welcome all of our panelists here today. As you can see, we have a wide variety of agencies being represented, so this should be a really great conversation. I always like to start out by asking our panelists a little bit about, quickly, because we only have so much time, about what the hiring process is in your school district. So Ryan, why don't we start with you?
Sure. So really, the hiring in Brockton really happens on two different fronts. One is at the central office, the human resources department down at the central office. They really process all the paperwork, the applications, run your query check, and check your transcripts and such. The interviewing process really happens at the building level. So I always encourage candidates to really kind of attack it from both fronts. Send all your information down to the central office at Human Resources so you can get your application on file. But also, send your information out to the individual schools, because really what happens is if we do have an opening, we will contact Human Resources to say, I have a third grade opening, can you send me some resumes for me to look at? But also the resumes that I've collected over, the months as well, I kind of put them all together and start to go through that. And sometimes I'll find that, you know, the resumes that have been sent to me also have been sent to Human Resources, but there have been times where resumes just came to me and not HR, and I found great candidates. So I always encourage you to do both, but certainly it happens really, you know, like I said, on both fronts, through the Human Resources office, but also at the school level.
And Ryan, Brockton's obviously a really large school district. You don't use School Spring or any of those kind of...
They do. Okay. They do use School Spring, so certainly I would encourage you to look on there. I know the Globe, they've advertised in the past in the Globe. A lot of times what happens with Brockton is, you know, just because of the budget season, we never really know what we're going to have usually until late spring. So a lot of times, you know, openings just pop up, and so principals are kind of starting at the end of the year to get some candidates in. So that's why I said definitely send your information to the schools, but certainly, you know, be looking at School Spring and such.
Great, thank you. Ian, what's hiring like at your district?
Let's see, hiring in Natick. Well, I would reiterate Ryan's point. Put paper in the hands of people. Our online applicant management system, I currently have about 750 applicants for elementary teaching positions. There's no way I'm getting through all 750, so we do get through a lot of those, but getting your paper into the hands of people is a really good idea, so I want to reiterate that. In Natick, I'm an elementary principal, we have 5 elementary schools. We hire together collaboratively as a team. So our hiring process, this is well-timed, it's already started. We conduct screening interviews of our candidates. So in Natick, you have a 10 to a 15 minute first interview. And really our job there is to determine whether or not candidates are a fit for the district. So we're not looking at skills at that point. We're looking at disposition, value systems, philosophy, whether or not you're actually going to jive with how we operate in Natick. We do that together as a team. We screened just over 100 candidates. Over the past 2 days. It's a very competitive job market, for sure. Hopefully this will be helpful to you in navigating that competitive market. From there, we go to a more of a performance-based evaluation of candidates. Typically, you would come to a panel interview with very structured questions, 12 or 13 people at the table. We give our candidates 24 hours in advance of the interview a packet of student work samples and data, and your job is to come to that panel prepared to present. We give you a set of focus questions, not loosely to direct your presentation, but really we want to see what you can get up in front of us and do in terms of your analysis of student work, your ability to dig in and understand what those students are capable of, how you would plan, how would you communicate with parents, things of that nature. So, and then from there, if we need to go to some kind of a tiebreaker, we'll bring you in to teach. So it's pretty quick for our process. We tend to wrap that process up in the period of about 2 weeks. We like to get out fast and early and get people in the door. Our central office is not as involved. They do collect resumes for us. They do get us out to these recruitment fairs to collect resumes and things of that nature. But it's much more, and I think as a smaller school system, it's much more delegated out to the buildings. So that's in a nutshell, very broadly speaking. We do use School Spring and things of that nature. Hopefully that's helpful. There's more to it, but that's the big picture of our hiring process.
So we go from large to small to enormous. So Amanda, can you tell us a little bit about the Boston process?
Sure. So in the past couple of years, we've completely flipped how we do hiring in the district. And we've offered hiring autonomy to every single school. We've given school leaders the opportunity to hire who they want to hire and who's going to be the best fit for their community and their school. So the way that works is all of our job postings are up on our hiring site, which is teachboston.org. And there's a way to kind of get seen by even more principals. So yes, apply to individual jobs. Principals will see you, will be looking through their applicants and contacting you about interviews. But there's a job posting up there that you have to search for because there are over 800 jobs posted up there. It's called the district-wide priority pool. And what that does is it allows you to submit all of your information, your resume, your cover letter, your certifications to this district-wide pool. And so any school leader who's searching for someone like you will find you. if I'm a principal and you only apply to my individual position, I'm the only person who can see you when people go in and search for your certifications. However, if you have applied to my individual position and the district-wide pool, not only will I be able to see you, but any of my colleagues searching for someone with your qualifications will be able to see you too. So you definitely want to make sure that it's very easy. Once you're in our system and build your profile, you can click through and apply to as many jobs as you're interested in, including the district-wide pool. In terms of the actual hiring process at the school level, that is up to the school. People ask me a lot, what is a BPS school like? And the answer is that there is absolutely no definition of what a BPS school is like, because we have so many different kinds, and every school really is its own community and has its own feel. Some schools like to have very traditional interviews with their school hiring team. A lot want to have you do a demo lesson with their students. Some want to see videos and portfolios. Some want to do a group interview where they're having you do kind of discussions and activities and observing. So it really varies. However, all principals go through our hiring site, teachboston.org, to schedule interviews. And once you're scheduled and invited to an interview, you get all of the information about the school and the process and what you need to know. As long as you're prepared to demonstrate everything you know, you should be totally fine. So yes, brief overview, hiring site, district-wide pools, and then it all depends on what school you're interviewing for.
Great, and we end with George, who is in a regional school district, probably small to medium size, I would say.
We're about 4,000 students. We have 7 schools, 4,000 students in Whitman-Hanson. We do it a little bit differently. It is really pretty much site-based. You will apply through school spring. However, everybody applies through school spring. So why are you different? Why am I going to look at yours? What's going to make yours? You know, some of it's dependent upon the job, but you also want to always follow up with the individual job or the individual principal themselves. In Whitman-Hanson, it'll say to the office of the superintendent, or it'll say the superintendent's name. It goes to the administrative assistant, and then we can go from there and look online or get the physical copies. But then it's also important that you follow up with that individual principal, because that's where all the connections are made. And in Whitman-Hanson, we don't do it as a team. Being more regional, we sometimes always don't see eye to eye with our folks across town, things like that. Human nature plays a role. So we pretty much do it on our own. I've had the ability to hire 52 people that are in my building, and it is that connection that you see that was talked about earlier. So how do you get noticed on school spring? How do you get noticed aside from school spring? You should take all these hints, but definitely follow up with the individual person and the individual person's name. I know you're more interested if I get something in my building that says George Ferro on it, as opposed to the copy of it. In doing so, though, and in applying for so many jobs, just be sure that you're actually writing like my name properly. You're actually writing my school. It doesn't say Bridgewater Raynham on it or something like that, because that is also a way to get noticed, but it's also a way to get lost.
Bad way.
It's also a way to get lost very quickly, because the online presence is so big and there's so many to choose from. So you just need to be careful, but you do need to work your individual way into a school also.
Amandra, I heard you make specific reference to searching by certification, so when they're in your system. Now, a lot of these folks are student teaching now, and given the fact that the spring's the busiest time for the State Department of Ed in terms of issuing licenses, it can take a couple of months. What would they, they could apply, would they put pending?
Or? Yes, and this is so important. I cannot say this enough. If you don't put down the licenses you expect to hold by August 15th, no one will find you when they search for you. All you're doing is screening yourself out of the process. There's an opportunity to list any license and endorsement that you plan on having and just list it as pending. That's totally fine. That's not a count against you. All that that means is that any hiring offer that you get, you could get hired today in BPS. That hire would just be contingent on you having the necessary licensure in hand by August 15th. So again, if you don't put down your licensure, all you're doing is screening yourself out. So make sure that you put down everything that you anticipate having.
And I heard you mention endorsement too. So all of these folks are either are eligible for the Sheltered English Immersion Endorsement because they're in teacher preparation programs right now, so there's a place for them to indicate that.
Yes, and that means that you guys are ahead of the game. As I'm sure you all know, the state of Massachusetts is going to require that teachers hold the SEI certification, but BPS is implementing that ahead of the Justice Department's order, so we are actually requiring all our teachers for this coming school year to either hold or show proof of progress towards an SEI endorsement. So again, if you don't put it down, you're gonna get filtered out. So if you anticipate holding it, if you anticipate making significant progress towards it by August 15th, put it down and you can list it as pending.
Great, so that does give you a little bit of a leg up since Massachusetts just implemented that fairly recently, so someone who might have completed a program a couple of years ago may not be in possession of that endorsement. It's not easy to get, so you're really, it's really great that it's part of your program. Well, I see a question already, so. No. Right now, there's a Sheltered English Immersion endorsement for teachers, and there's one for administrators who supervise teachers, but not for support services yet. Yeah. But it's good information to have, you know, if you were to get information on how to work with English language learners, I think it only helps your resume for sure. Any other thoughts about endorsements? Actually, why don't we just kind of launch right into what can these folks do to make themselves stand out from the hundreds of applications that you may get? What do you think is particularly important? George, you've got your hand up already.
I think one of the first things is, especially now with school spring and all your online, everybody tends to look the same. So when you put your cover letter, when you make your resume, or when you have to let the people looking at them know that one, you're certified, and what your certification is, or what are your highest three, what are the three things in your cover letter that really are gonna make you stand out? Because really, sometimes it's all about standing out. We hired a social studies person last year, hired her this night from this night last year. And one of the things that took place was that when I looked over her resume, and after she made the initial contact and called me and emailed me the next morning, was one of the things was that everything was right there, right in front of me. I knew her certifications, I knew that she was ready to go, I knew that her background was there, and I didn't have to go look for her. I think sometimes what happens is when you're a new employee or you're pending, you're not sure. So sometimes you list your certifications like on the back of on the next part of the resume or at the end of the resume, and it's away from education, and it's not right up in front. And for a social studies position, I had 479 applicants for one social studies position. I might not have hired the next Horace Mann, but I had to stop and start and design a criteria. So if you're putting your things out there, make sure the people looking at it know right away. You're certified, you know, you're licensed, you have your graduate, all of your things in order, so that you stay in that pile of we must look at. Any questions tend to get moved to another pile, and then you can kind of just sort of go through who's qualified first and then begin your search.
Hey, good tip. So list those licenses, grade levels, fields, and then any endorsements, SEI or any of the other endorsements in the state. Yes?
I'm graduating in January with my master's and my initial license in severe special ed. And I know January sort of an odd time to start applying for jobs. I didn't know if I should start in January applying for jobs or start when the jobs are posted later on, closer to the summer.
I would recommend is start applying, because what happens is programs are created during the year because students may move into the district and all of a sudden they don't have a special education program for them, so let's create a class. Then they're going to start looking for a teacher, and you know, if typically at that time of year, you know, people have already been placed into jobs, so it's really hard to find a qualified candidate. So if you have that license and you're certified come January, I'd start applying right away, without a doubt.
And we actually incentivize people to apply to our district-wide priority pools early. They open in November, and if you apply before our open post jobs go up, you have the opportunity for additional informational interviews and additional kind of priority flagging that you're not guaranteed to get if you apply after the jobs post, and then all of our jobs post the first week in March. So, but I also would reiterate, what he shared also, because there are openings that happen in the middle of the year, and knowing that there are candidates in our pool who aren't current students is really, it's a really good thing for our principals, because they're looking for folks who can step into a role immediately.
And let's just go back again to the question about rising to the top of the pile. George did a great job of telling us a little bit about the resume and where you should put that, those endorsements and those licenses. Do any of our other panelists have any thoughts about how to make yourself shine in a pile?
I think, you know, I would just add that, you know, I think George, you know, George's point is well taken. The one thing, I've talked to a lot of principals about hiring over the years. I work a lot with our Elementary Principals Association. And the one constant amongst the principals is licensure. It's the only constant. You know, every principal looks differently at candidates. And I think that's one of the struggles of the job search that you face, right, is I can stand up here and tell you all of what I look for, and you could put 100 principals up there, and you'd get variations on what they would tell you. But licensure's it. If your licensure's not there and it's not clear, there's a better chance you're going to get passed up. I think in terms of standing out, you know, to me, obviously, you know, the licensure thing's important, but, you know, I want to see, you know, on paper, I look for diversity of experience. It's not just about your student teaching. You know, you don't have a lot of direct teaching experience at this point in your career, but that doesn't mean that the other experiences that you've had in your life are not of value. So I look for diversity of experience. I also look for a person who has really taken time and energy to put together themselves on paper, because this is you. And you know, so there are little things that you can do resume and cover letter wise, like, does it flow? Does it work? Is it categorically, you know, are you just giving me a smatch of stuff that you've done, or are you being thoughtful about, here's my leadership experience, you know, here's what I've done as a person to take the lead in different situations. Here's what I've done in terms of teaching. Here's what I've done in terms of community service, volunteering, etc. You know, so I think the candidates, you know, paper's kind of a gamble, because again, like I said, every principal is different, but for me, it's the candidates who have really taken the time to make themselves appear on that paper. I think that's super important. So it's not necessarily about what's there; it's the investment, and it's the you take pride in what you put forward.
And for us, in terms of the technical part of things, we are looking for. Just due to the nature of our amazing students, we're looking for folks who have content license and licensure in things like special education and English as a second language. Even if you're not teaching a technical ESL or special ed class, a lot of school leaders are looking for folks with that dual licensure because of the population in many of our schools. We're looking for language fluency. Notice I didn't say Spanish fluency. We have 8 official languages in the district, and our students speak over 80 languages. I was speaking with a second grade teacher the other day who has 24 students, and not a single one of them speaks the same language at home. So it's not about a language that we're looking for, it's any language that we're looking for in fluency. And then in terms of the kind of intangibles standing out, one of the biggest things that we look for is that you're going to be a fit with our district's core values, that you've shown that you've done the research, that you know who we are as a district and what we value. And one of those biggest core values is our diversity. And we do not see our diversity as a challenge to be overcome. We see it as one of our biggest assets as a district. So we need teacher candidates who are coming in with that exact same mindset, that the diversity of the students that they'll be teaching and working with and the communities that they'll be in is one of the reasons why you're so excited to be in Boston, not one of the things that you're prepared to overcome. I think that's a big one.
I think it's also important that when you put yourself on paper and that you show that you've taken the time to do it, we also have to realize that every principal, we have all kids in the building. So maybe at this point in your life, you don't have a vast array of experiences in teaching, but something about interests, something about your work, even if you were the lifeguard at the local thing for ages 3 to 8 and taught swimming lessons, if you were the local baseball coach for the Little League, even if you did it with your dad or whatever. Yeah, I mean, you need to write some of these things down maybe under interests, or you need to do that, because when you look for an entry-level teacher position, you're given the gift, if you are the successful candidate, of a possible full of a career right there. So, and it's a, more than about always having everything proper. We're going into the business to teach kids. And so it's more than just on paper, I have everything lined up. So at the interview, or when you're trying to get an interview stage, those things like interest or what makes you up, or something a little bit about you that might set you apart, isn't always a bad thing to let a prospective interviewer know. Because if I'm interviewing, I have all my after school activities, I have all my clubs, I have all my local sports that I'm all still a part of. But if you're telling me that you were in college, that you were in My Fair Lady, and you designed the sets and you did that, I'm thinking, whoa, okay, you have all your ducks in a row for social studies maybe, or you're already math certified, but you also might be this. That might make you a more well-rounded candidate, or at least help you rise to the top. So you shouldn't sell yourself short on the things that you might not think should go into a resume, but those things could actually be an added benefit for you. Talk it over with your roommates, talk it over with your parents, talk it over with your advisors, talk it over and say, do you think that I should put this? And then at least you'll have a, we'll have at least a clearer picture when we make our pools for who we're gonna personally interview.
And I think for us, it really comes down to, you know, looking at what experiences you have had and really where. You know, obviously Brockton being an urban setting, I do like to see candidates have some type of urban experience, whether it's in Brockton or it might be Fall River, New Bedford, or maybe they did something up in Lowell or Lawrence, or you know, one of the major cities. That's not to say if you haven't, that's going to exclude you. And then what I also like to see is, you know, a lot of times you'll write on your resume, I planned and taught lessons in a third grade classroom. I want to know more about what reading program you're using. I want to know about what math program you're using. Because again, if, you know, let's just say you're using Scott Forsman, and we are as well, okay, that gives you a leg up because you have some experience with that program. Again, that's not to say if you're not, you know, you're going to be blacklisted. But again, those types of things for me, you know, all of a sudden catch my eye. Oh, they're familiar with Envisions Math. They know the program. The other big thing is social emotional learning. You really want to catch somebody's eye and talk a little bit about that and your experience of social emotional learning. And if you don't have experience, you know, again, that you realize that that is important, you know, for our children's education, in addition to the academic piece. But, you know, don't be afraid to go ahead and list what type of textbooks you're using, what type of programs. I've administered the DRA or the DIBLs, you know, U-Star assessment, those type of things we want to see on your resumes, because again, it catches our eye, especially if we're using those type of programs.
And I want to echo that. That's one of my biggest kind of pet peeves, is seeing on your resume experience, first grade teacher, and the first bullet is taught first grade curriculum. Thank you. We know what first grade teachers do. We want to know what books you use, what curriculum, things like that. If you have results, show your impact on your resume. We want you to be as specific as possible. School leaders know what first grade teachers do. They want to know what you do and the impact that you had on your students, how many you worked with, for how long, specific lessons that went really well, things like that. Being as specific as possible is one of our biggest tips to folks when talking about resumes.
How do you measure your effectiveness as a teacher, being able to articulate that during the process? I heard a lot of references to fit tonight. Can you talk a little bit about, I think it was you, Ian, that talked about one of the first things your district does is talk about whether the person is fit to be in the Natick public schools. So how do you determine fitness? Are there questions that you ask, or?
There are questions that we ask. Determining fit is really, obviously it's a function of the school system, right? So every school system operates a little bit differently and they have different value sets. So for us, it's about, you know, as a group of principals being crystal clear on what it is that's most important to us as a district and most important to us as elementary schools in terms of really the habits of mind, the dispositions, the belief systems of the teachers. That's what's most important to us, so we screen for that. You can't teach a person to believe that all kids can learn. That is something that is inside of you. Or let me say, I don't like to talk in absolutes. It's much harder to teach that than it is to teach someone to use a Scott Forsman reading program. I can teach you how to teach reading. Can't teach the love kids. So for us, that's it, which is why they're 10 to 15 minute screening interviews. opportunities. I don't need more than 5 minutes to know whether or not a candidate's going to work in our school system. And then from there, we go into, let us see what you can do. And you know, we feel for us, it's definitely for the candidates who we interview, it's a little bit of a shock to the system because they're more accustomed to a longer, more in-depth initial interview. So that's a little bit, you know, we take a lot of time to explain that to our candidates because we don't want people walking out like, whoa, I blew it or what happened? You know, but we want to be fair to, you know, the candidate and to us in terms of our time. So we do it very briefly, but it is, it's key, and which is why you're hearing it across the deck here. And I think that's also something to be thinking about as candidates. You're going to interview in a lot of different places. You're not going to get a lot of jobs, and you have to just keep your head up and know that that's not necessarily about you. It's about whether or not the school system felt like you were a fit for that job. You know, and that's not a function of your skill set per se. It could be, but you know, you want to be thinking about why you're not getting positions, but always keep, I remember that. I mean, interviewing in Massachusetts, I came from Norfolk, Virginia, where I got a job like day one. Massachusetts, it took me months to get my first job teaching, and that was very hard. So, but you gotta remember that, just keep your chin up, you'll get there. It's just, fit is a big, big, big to-do for us.
I actually saw some hands going up, and I love you folks, because I could read through these canned questions for an hour before anyone gets brave enough to ask a question, and you guys are stepping right up to the plate. So I'll start with you in the black right there.
I was curious, I know you had talked about the certifications is important to have right on the front of your resume. How would you feel about someone who is pursuing their master's? For me, that has always been part of my plan, so I was hoping to be a first-year teacher and pursue my master's that night. Would that turn you off as an educator? I realize being a first-year teacher is taking on a lot in itself, but do you see that as a positive that they would be pursuing your master's, or more as a negative that you feel as though they would have enough time to put into the classroom? I wasn't sure how to approach that on my resume.
I don't see it as a negative. Obviously, you know, as an educator, you have to develop yourself professionally. And one of those things is obviously as a new teacher going back to get your master's. So I think it's a reality that we all know you're going to have to go through, whether it's year one, or year two, or year three. I personally wouldn't view it as a negative. I don't know how my colleagues feel, but I don't think it would. I don't want to say it wouldn't matter either way. I think people would be impressed to see that you're going for your master's, but I don't think it would be a negative.
No, I think it's great. I mean, I think you should say what it is that you're doing. So if that's pursuing your master's right now, are you going to be a first-year teacher? It's going to be daunting, but being a first-year teacher is daunting. So you might as well get it out of the way and go.
Well, and I would add to that, I don't know what my colleagues would say. You know, so not a problem for me. But I would say the same thing, George, like put it on there. Because if it is a problem for the principal, it's probably not going to be a good fit. You know, it works for you in that way too, to really paint the picture of yourself, because you don't want to be working in a place where you're not a good fit either. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, that makes total sense to think that in the opposite way, and really feel like that.
And I think the old adage where, you know, oh, if you get a master's degree, you're too expensive, they're not going to hire a new teacher with a master's degree, is really gone by the wayside. Now, I mean, it's such an integral part of our licensing system in Massachusetts that eventually the expectation is that absolutely you're going to have a master's degree. So I don't think you have to worry about that as much anymore. There's another question right here.
I was just curious of the differences between your guys' first year mentoring programs for teachers. Could you just run me through typically what you guys would do for entry level teaching position?
Sure. Well, for us, every single first-year teacher in our district gets a new teacher developer, and they are a master teacher within the district who has been trained and works with our educator development staff to mentor first-year teachers, both in formal ways through things like non-evaluative observations and feedback, structured feedback, but also in informal ways to be a support system, to be someone you can ask questions of, that you can receive feedback from, all of that you may not want to ask your, you know, principal or resident lead teacher or something like that. We also have a lot of opportunities for all of our teachers, not just our first year teachers, to be a part of different networking communities, whether that's from affinity groups or subject areas or interests. We have a lot of different networking, social, and professional groups and leadership opportunities for all of our teachers, but for our first-year teachers also.
I know Whitman-Hanson has a great mentoring program district-wide because I've presented at that a couple of times. So.
Yeah, you have. So basically, we do it by district, by all levels. You come in 3 days before, you get a mentor from your building. That's the formal one. 3 days before, you get the lay of the land, everything from soup to nuts. Here's all of our people that you're going to be working with. Here's some things you need to know. You have your educator evaluation training there. And then you go on a tour of both towns. You have a, you know, all of those things. And then informally at the school, you also, aside from your formal mentor, we also set you up with an informal mentor. Sometimes you always can't have the person at your grade level who's your mentor formally, but we try to do that informally also. We're lucky enough in our school, we have, you teach on the same team, you have the same exact schedules with the people that you're teaching next to. You have both your prep periods and your PLCs off at the same time. So there's a lot of time for collaboration. All new mentors go through the year-long class, then they have the second year, where they also, it's more of a project-based class, but you also meet. So hopefully at the end of that, you're well-seasoned in everything from how our grade system works to all the help that you need in being a first-year teacher and what comes with that.
I'm less familiar with Brockton and Natick. Can you focus on that?
Sure. Brockton, we also have a new teacher orientation before school starts. So it's a two-day orientation. So all new teachers are brought in, go over similar things, you know, the operations, policy, procedures of the district, get you right about training, and then you are assigned a mentor. We typically try to assign you a mentor from the building, from the grade level. Ours is really more of a job application that the mentors have to apply for. If for some reason no one in the building has applied, it may go to someone outside the building, which then kind of does create some problems. But again, we'll kind of set you up with an informal mentor as well. And certainly the same thing within the content areas. You know, I have a brand new art teacher. There's only one art teacher in the building, so she didn't have an in-building art mentor. So we were able to get a mentor in the building just to kind of help with first year things, but then also the art department, department head was able to secure her an informal art mentor from outside the building. So, and again, they meet monthly, you meet monthly as with your mentor. They do have professional development opportunities throughout the district, and then they also have, the superintendent does have meetings, usually I think there's 4 to 5 meetings per year with the new teachers. It's very informal, she just likes to bring you in, you know, attendance is not required, just to kind of see how things are going, get your feedback on things, and just kind of talk about district level issues as opposed to individual issues.
Okay. Natick is roughly the same as what you've heard in terms of the just kind of the nuts and bolts of making sure that our new teachers have the lay of the land and access to the resources, processes, procedures, etc. What I would add to the Natick does that I've been really pleased with over the years is Natick really sees it as more of a 3-year induction than it is kind of a first year scenario. And the two pieces that, you know, I came to Natick 7 years ago, the two pieces that really stood out to me, that over those first 3 years, not only do you have the mentor, the informal mentoring relationships, but you're required to take 2 courses. We're all required to take, I was required to take them when I started. Studying the Skillful Teacher is one of those courses. We host that course on campus, we pay for it. You don't have to do anything but sign up and show up. But really what's important to me for new teachers especially is that it provides us with a common language for teaching and learning. So when I'm coming into your classroom and looking at your practice, I'm talking to you using the language of studying the Skillful Teacher. So we have that common verbiage and common just kind of lens on teaching and learning, which I think really benefits our new teachers, not only in the kind of the supervisory relationship that they have with me, but in their team relationships in the building and across the district. And the second piece is an equity and expectations course. So this is really looking at the cultural proficiency. So the SST is kind of the mechanics of the teaching and how we expect classrooms to be run, and then we like to polish teachers off with that cultural proficiency lens, making sure that they understand every learner that's coming into that classroom, that they know how to work with those children and those families. So that's something that I think, you know, really I appreciate about Natick's approach to the new teacher induction process.
It's a fair question to ask, because just as the master's degree is one component of your development as a teacher across the licensing continuum, so is verification of induction and mentoring in the first couple of years of employment. So those are good questions to ask. Oh, sure, absolutely.
You know, the other thing I want you, and you won't feel comfortable with this, but obviously we're resources. You know, as a principal, yes, we're evaluating you and we hire and possibly fire you. But you also have to realize that we're there for you. You know, our job is not to, as a first year teacher, find out what you're doing wrong. You're going to struggle. You're a first year teacher. We all struggled. You're probably going to go home and cry at night. That's okay. But we know those things are going on. But our job is to help you. So you have to be willing. You know, obviously you'll go to your mentor, you'll go to your grade level colleagues. But I find it more impressive when a new teacher will come to me and say, I'm really struggling with A. Can you help me out? Any strategies, any ideas? Or could I go see someone else, you know, teach this particular strategy? We're a resource for you. So don't hesitate to, you know, to use this. Again, you will, because you'll think it's a bad thing, but it's really not. We'd rather have you come to us as opposed to struggle and flounder. You know, we want to be able to help you and get you through it. We know first year is tough, and as a second and third, and you know, every year after that, but they do get easier. But we want to be able to help you in your careers.
And I'll put a shameless plug in for the fact that the university actually runs new teacher seminars every month. And they have a monthly theme that the new teachers come up with. So as alums of the university, you can come back and talk to faculty if you're uncomfortable talking with your principals. I thought that was a great offer though, Ryan. Do you guys all offer that to your new teachers?
Yeah, absolutely.
Totally.
Yeah, that's great.
Concur.
That's...
Once we hire you, it's my, you know, we'd rather help you than have to get rid of you. A lot of paperwork on the other end. We'd rather see you do well.
Yes, over there.
I've observed both in Brockton District and Whitman-Hanson, and I've seen very different teachers within the districts themselves. I was just wondering, characteristic-wise, what do you see in new candidates and putting forth in their resumes just from that and then going into teaching and stuff? Very different aspects of all the teachers I've seen. They're all good teachers.
And so I do think, you know, like Ian mentioned, that consistency in terms of common language and common expectations, you certainly have those for all your teachers at a grade level in a building across the district. But I think you also have to look at the individual person. They're going to all have different personalities, different character traits. So you just have to come to appreciate, you know, the teacher as an individual and what they bring to the table. And certainly what they maybe bring to the table in Whitman-Hanson and Brockton might be different. Their experiences might be different in terms of the students they're dealing with. But again, I think it's the way they deal with them, their response to the students, and again, their response to, you know, working with colleagues or working with administration in terms of their resiliency. You know, can they encounter a problem and bounce back from it? Are they, you know, willing to grow as a professional? Do they seek out help? I think I look more at the individual person. I do want to see some consistency across the grade levels, but in terms of personality, I don't want a robot in every classroom, you know, acting the same way. I don't know if that answered your question.
I think a lot of it is, are they acting under the guise of what your school's norms and culture are? Like in my building, you have to love kids, and you have to be able to have families as part of the learning process, because they're usually not our kids. So you're really just adopting them for 6 hours a day. And that is something that you have to hold high, because, and you have to enter into a relationship with their parents as well as the student. But when you go through different classrooms, my seventh grade, I have unique individuals in a lot of my different classes teaching those classes. But their same premise is that we like kids and we're here to help kids, and we're going to move forward so that they can achieve to the best of their ability. But what you're looking for as a principal, obviously, is the teacher still delivering the same content message throughout the class? Might be a different style, might be a different way, but one, the teachers act in response to the culture of the building, and two, they're acting and following the tenets of what the curriculum is. So it can be different, but under the guise of what's best for that building.
And I was going to say something similar, that it's really important in any interview situation, but in BPS, look to do your research about the school that you're visiting. Because we have different types of schools in structure, both in terms of length of the day and legal policies and things like that, but also every single school is completely different in their community and their feel and their discipline systems and their curriculum focus. So we have some that teach the curriculum through an arts lens, through a science lens that focuses in on the health sciences focus, you know, and so making sure that you're not coming into an interview saying, I'm a first grade teacher, this is my first grade demo lesson, and doing the same lesson in every interview that you do. Knowing the school that you're going to, knowing the community that you're going into, knowing the values of that school. Every single school in BPS has its own website. So there's no, this isn't like a trick to see if you can guess the culture of a school before you get to an interview. It's all out there. And so it's a combination of researching the district as a whole in terms of how do we define effective teaching, and then fitting that into your research on the school that you're visiting. So knowing that, yes, every single teacher in BPS needs to have the content knowledge and instruction differentiation and cultural competency and whatever other standards we have, but then doing some really intentional thinking around how that fits into the Edward M. Kennedy Academy of Health Science or the Fenway High School for the Arts. You know, how are you going to differentiate your interview to show that not only do you meet all of our competencies and rock them, but you also know the school and can fit into that school's culture and values.
Well, I think hopefully these folks know that a lot of the statistics on the student populations available on the profiles on the State Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed website, and don't forget to click on selected characteristics like numbers of English language learners and special ed. But you talk specifically about things like the almost like the mission of each building and a little bit of, even about the disciplining process. So is that all widely available on all four of our school district websites here? And is that something that definitely should check out, and that's the kind of information they find?
Well, it's something that we talk about a lot with prospective teachers in our district, is that none of this is trying to be a gotcha moment. We try to make it as easy as possible for you to understand what we want. We have something that we just finished last year, which is really exciting. It's called the Interactive Rubric. So the teacher evaluation rubric has been available publicly forever. But what we've developed as a district is the interactive version of that rubric. You can click on any standard within our teacher, our standards of effective teaching. You can see look fors, you can see videos of effective practice. It's kind of a cheat sheet for defining effective instruction and quality educators in our district, as well as all of the information on every single school has their assessment data, their student population data, their family engagement school climate survey data, their teaching and learning data, their demographics, their English language learners, their everything is on the site. It's all publicly available. It's all right there. So there's really no excuse not to know about the kind of school that you're going into, but there's also no kind of hidden behind the curtains trying to fool you into not doing well in an interview. We want you to find all that information and be solid that you're a fit for the school as well as you, you're a fit for the school as well as the school being a fit for you.
And I would build on that. In terms of differentiating yourself, there are candidates who can read websites, and that's awesome. And candidates will come to the table and recite my mission, recite my vision, recite my core values, and lots of cool things about the school, which tells me that you can surf the web and you can read, which are good characteristics. However, you know, the candidates who stand out are the candidates who are in the middle of telling me their story and using their anecdotal, you know, here's what I was doing in the classroom. And, you know, what really stood out to me about the school is when I was looking at the website and I saw this part of your discipline process and how that just spoke to how I managed this situation, and it felt like a real fit for me. You take that information, for me, you take that information and you figure out how it ties to your narrative and the responses and the stories that you want to present in that interview. Because again, like I said, that just in terms of thinking about separating yourself, reading websites is good, it's awesome. But going a step further to tie that into who you are and how you're going to respond in that interview situation is, for me, really important.
Yeah. And I think it's also important that we might not think of it like this, but you are on the verge of being granted a career. So in 36 years, if you're a brand new teacher and you can stay at that same building, and that's going to take a massive amount of hard work
once you get the job and you actually become a teacher or an educator. But it's going to also need hard work to make you stand out in that interview process to be granted that opportunity to have a career. So when you ask questions, when you're asked a question like, do you have any questions? Is there anything we can answer for you? And you haven't brought anything up yet?
Yes.
We're trying to let you know, hey, did you do your homework? Are you willing to work hard? Have you worked hard yet to be at this table? Because the number of resumes that come in and the number of interviews that are actually granted are not the same. So you have to make sure that when you're granted an interview, everybody has a shot. You get an interview, love it, you have a shot, then you've got to start doing the hard work right from there. Because you don't know who's on that committee. In my building, I always have guidance or support staff on every interview committee. Because they went to school, they're supposed to read people better than I am sometimes. So they're gonna help to say, is that a fit? But you really don't know who's there. So you wanna make sure you do your homework and you wanna start that hard work that you're gonna do for the rest of your life. But you need to start it there at that interview process also. So knowing how it ties in and that you need to be prepared.
I want you all to get out a pen or your phone or whatever it is that you use to take notes on, because I'm going to pause here and just make you really happy that you went to this session and didn't blow it off and go right to the job fair. I want our panels to think about one question that you typically ask in an interview, and it has particularly important meaning for you. It could be a deal breaker in terms of a reflective response on the behalf of the candidate. So does anyone want to jump in and think right away about what's a question that these folks can expect to have, and it provides a revealing amount of information about candidate readiness for positions?
I always, not right off the bat, but as the interview's going on, always ask a question about, give me a time that you struggled. I don't always want to hear about how great things are and how well everything went. I want to also know about a struggle that you've had, whether it's dealing with a child, whether it was a particular lesson you planned that just didn't go well, and what did you do to fix it? You know, what type of supports did you put in place for the child, or how did you go back and fix the lesson? Did you have to reteach it? Was it a case of you were looking at assessment data and realized that, you know, the kids bombed what you were trying to teach? I want to hear about those situations, because again, you know, you can get there and really sell yourself about all the great things you've done. I want to be able to see that you know, can struggle a little bit and still bounce back. So that's something.
So
I did.
What have you learned from things that have gone wrong? Yeah.
Do you want your students to like you? That's my favorite.
Oh, that sounds like a trick question.
It's a tough one to answer, and it can be a deal breaker for me. Yeah, I mean, how that question is answered reflects a lot about, which is why I leave it very nebulous, because I don't box the question in any way, because I want to get at what's underneath and what's in, like I said, what is it that you believe and what is your value system around kids? And that question really gets at it, and you can learn a lot about a person from how they answer it. So that's one of my favorites.
Do you want your students
to like you? Do you want your students
like
to like you?
Okay.
Most interviews in our district will have some form of a question around your approach to diversity in the classroom. Whether that's cultural diversity, linguistic diversity, racial or ethnic diversity, or diversity of learning styles and abilities, it could vary. But I told that story about the teacher who all of her students speak a different language at home. That's a kind of diversity that you can't necessarily prepare for in a classroom in your ed prep program. And similar to, you know, what was just said, it can really get to someone's true kind of core values when thinking about those questions, because how you incorporate your students' cultures and languages and backgrounds and abilities into the classroom can show much more of your alignment with our district and our school values then your answer to my core value is diversity, which is great. We want to hear it and we want to know that, but you can really get to the root of it with kind of how you bring and approach diversity in the classroom.
I like to ask you point blank, tell me what sets you apart and why I should hire you. Because the reason why I like to ask that question is, it's going to tell me if you are a reflective learner. Because you can say the greatest things in the world, but did you think about what it means to have this job, what it means your makeup? Because as soon as you get a successful position, you're going to enter the educator evaluation program. You know you're going to have to do your goals. Your goals are going to have to be reflective. Every time you get a write-up, it's going to be reflective, whether that's formal or informal. So let's start that process of hard work right now. And I want to hear what you have to say, because you might have been so nervous in that interview. You might have an inkling that there's something that we're trying to pull out from you. And then for some, it's like the deal breaker. Hey, tell me why I should hire you. Please, tell me what's going to set you apart, that you should be given this opportunity to be a teacher at the Whitman Middle School. And it's your core. So tell me why. And for some, it goes into, I thought about this, I know exactly what I want to do, I'm on the website, I know what I want, this is why. For some, it's like, whoa, that wasn't on the list that they gave me for my last class. I'm not sure. But it just gives you an insight, it goes back to fit, goes back to culture, and goes back to you're entering a place, and is it the right fit? And are you, have you spent enough time thinking about you? Because for when you're in front of a class, there's going to be kids going to ask you a question. You're not ready for it. You don't know the answer. You're not sure what the heck's going on. And you have 47 minutes left of class. So you're going to have to be able to be a reflective learner, get that skill, get quick at it, and then be able to sell yourself. And it starts right at that interview.
Great. That was really helpful. Very reflective. And I think that's the kind of information that you don't normally get. Everyone knows, oh, they're going to ask me about my philosophy of education. But who would have thought they were going to ask me whether I like kids or not, or want my kids to like me, or what went wrong? So all of that's been really, really helpful. Thank you. Any other questions that we have out here in the audience?
Just a small question on the licensure in hands. I've seen it on School Spring for a couple jobs, and you guys said it. So does that mean order, like purchase and order a bunch of our license certificates, or is there like, is that what it is?
You're not going to get any more paper licenses from the State Department of Ed. They're like way too cheap now. So everything's in virtual land.
Okay.
But what you can do is you can go in yourself through your ELAR account and print your license. It will be unofficial. But what do you folks like to see as a true verification? Or are you using the Department of Ed's interface to?
Well, we're going to look up. That. I mean, if you have at least your MEPID number or you have your certificate number, that's fine also. But if you can print it out from ELAR, it's going to have all the information right there.
Okay.
So then we're going to have to go in and check it anyway.
Okay.
But if you have that piece of paper, it's so much better for
you.
So
it's good to put your MEPID in, my licensure number on my resume?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Right in the certification, put it right in there.
Okay.
Because let's cut to the chase, because that's going to move you into one pile or not.
Okay.
And when you're building your profile on our hiring site, even if there's a spot for you to put your MEPID right there. So.
That was kind of a rip-off that you don't get an actual thing in the mail that says, after all these years of schooling, you're officially blessed, but that's not the case anymore. Print it on nice paper, though.
Yeah.
It's really fancy paper. But that was a really good question. Any other questions out there about licensing? One quick thought, too, is all the folks have MEPIDs now because the new kind of protocol with preparation programs is they're getting a MEPID like right upon their introductory course. So you've got your MEPID, and then you're going to get your license number. And wouldn't it be convenient if they were the same thing? They're not. So your license number is actually going to be a different number than your MEPID number. So just keep that in mind as you're beginning to collect the documents that you need for the interview process, that they are different. Once you're given a license number, though, then all of your fields and levels and endorsements get listed under that. So you'll get one license number, even though you might hold multiple fields and levels. Any other questions? Back there.
I normally did come a few minutes late, and I know that you were talking about really how to stand out, especially now on School Spring. A lot of it is application, and I know before that there's a lot of face-to-face, and that's probably one of the biggest things I miss the most, is because sometimes you know, we all wonder, do we accurately reflect ourselves in the piece of paper versus how we portray ourselves face to face? I know a lot of times on school spring, a lot of them will say in huge, large fonts, no phone calls, please, no emails, things of that sort. And of course, you want to respect that about the particular school or the district that you're applying for. On certain parts on school spring, when it doesn't say do not call or do not email, I've heard a bunch of different answers that sometimes when you actually send something to, particularly for myself, like the guidance department head or the vice principal, whoever be collecting them, some of them say if you send it to the principal or the guidance department head, it's the 50-50. They're either going to welcome the opportunity that you went above and beyond and sent it out to make yourself stand out, and then other people say that you didn't follow the protocol and have actually taken people who emailed the principal or the guidance head off the list. And I'm just kind of wondering, and making yourself stand out, where you would see yourself, but again, I'm trying to rise above and make yourself stand out.
So when do you look professional follow-up versus being a stalker kind of thing, right? So, thoughts about that?
I mean, I would just say what I said earlier, which is the only constant in this search process is going to be you. You're going to encounter, you know, however many school systems there are in Massachusetts, and there, I mean, for elementary, there are 900 principals who have 900 varying opinions on the question you just asked. So I think the important thing is for you to be consistent in that hiring process and in that search process, because you're not going to be able to account for the variance that's out there. So I'm a principal, I love getting resumes in the mail. I have colleagues across town who hate getting resumes in the mail. I mean, it's very hard to know. So I'm the kind of person, if you send me a resume, chances are I'm going to get in touch with you.
That goes back to that right fit, because then they're going to find that offensive in that direct way. You want to have that different type of relationship.
And you have no way of knowing. And we can answer your question, but you know, that's four of us for representing probably, I don't know, 12, 1300 principals in the state of Massachusetts.
Thank you.
So yes.
Yes, I had a question. So as we were applying, you'll already have a copy of our cover letter and our resume. What other tangible items do you want us to bring to the interview process?
Portfolio. Some principals say, ugh, I don't have time to look through that. What's your thoughts? I mean, any other items?
For us, well, first of all, principals will tell you directly when they schedule an interview, because some have different ways of doing it. But in general, a portfolio is a really good thing to bring. But the one thing I'd say is don't like force it on the principal in the interview.
Don't wheel it in a crate. Select
it. Have it with you. You know, it's known that it's with you, and if they want to see it, they'll ask for it. And if they don't, that's not necessarily a bad sign. But don't sit there being like, and this is my portfolio, and pushing it in front of them, but bring it with you. That's definitely something that we recommend for folks to have.
You can also use the portfolio as a cheat sheet. If you're selective with what you put in there and you use it, so, oh, you know, that question on management's great. Here's how I do this. Here's what I do. And actually, right here is a picture of this little system that I put in place on FastPass around. Take a look. You know, I think when I was interviewing for teaching positions, that's how I used my portfolio. I wasn't like, do you want to look at my portfolio? I had management, I had instruction, I had assessment, and I had one or two things in there that I could go to, because if you're flipping around in that portfolio, you're done. You know, you have one or two things in there that you can slide out on the table to show people. That's an effective use of portfolio.
I think you should also, I think portfolios are tough, because I've had people bring in a crate and with the wheels and everything, and then I've had people just try to not get nervous. You get nervous at this opportunity sometimes. So I always ask for, you know, excuse me, do you know how many people are on the interview team? And so I would always prepare, whether I was a teacher or going for any administrative job, I would always prepare a small folder that would highlight some of those key things that I would leave with every single one of them. And so that, because some of the decisions, yes, you get to know the feel, you get to know, and then you go through six or seven, you go through eight of them, then you come back around with your group, and you decide, okay, now what separates the candidates now that we've seen them in person? So the ability to leave something that's not, that maybe you created your student teaching, that's something that you use, can be a useful tool. So you don't have to push it in the interview, but you leave it with them. So you don't have to gather, you don't have to get nervous about, can the secretary make a copy of that? You leave it right there. Again, it goes back to the hard work that's being done before the interview, but then a piece of you stays with them. So the piece of you on paper got you the interview,
We now have you as a person. You then leave, and we have something different about you yet at the interview, which can only be a benefit of it.
That gets to the heart of your question. Good. We have 5 minutes left, folks, so this is your chance. Ask the experts. Yes.
I was always told to just have one page for your resume. Does it matter how long it is?
I think it goes back to you. For me, it sometimes does. I think especially it depends where you're at in your life.
Right.
You know, if you have, depends. If this is your 17th job and it's in your 19th year, you definitely need to shorten that up because that might say something about transitional things. But I mean, I'm still a one-page person, especially at the level of depending on when you're coming in. I think it's all in one page. However, in that one page, you need to be selective. We know you did student teaching, so some bullets on that about the key things that you used. And then I would also think, tell me a little bit something about your experience maybe with children at that age if it's not part of student teaching. But the threes, the fours, the five pages that you sometimes get, I think kind of lose it depending on what job it is you're going for.
So leave off the high school career thing.
I mean, if you're coming in with 30-year career experience, 2 pages is completely understandable. 7 pages, no. 2 pages, completely understandable. If you're coming in and your resume is 2 pages long and you're just coming out of school and all of a sudden I see that you've listed like every travel sports team you played on when you were 10, it doesn't make sense. And if it's hard to whittle down your resume to one page, think about it as being just as customized as your cover letter. If your experience working at the ice cream shop over the summers doesn't demonstrate a level of skill, expertise, or competency that you want this principal to know, the principal doesn't need to know that you've been able to hold a job. That's great. But unless you're able to really demonstrate something that's related to that position through everything that's on your resume, it doesn't need to be on there. So making sure that your resume is just as tailored to whatever position you're going for as your cover letter would be.
And a shout out to Katie and her team because you've got a wonderful resource on this campus for looking at your resumes, and they do have evening hours that accommodate student teachers. So they can get that information on the Career Services website about making appointments and getting those resumes looked at. So definitely make use of some of the resources here on campus.
And I would just add to the resume piece, there's always the length question. And yeah, obviously, anything beyond, for me, 2 pages with a new teacher is over the top. But that's not necessarily about length. The other thing that, resumes that stand out are resumes that pique my interest, right? So it's part of it is getting down what you do. Part of it is also being strategic in terms of making people interested in you. So when I see something, first grade teacher or student taught, leverage project-based learning opportunities to engage students. Okay, you did. You told me what you did, but I want to know. I want to hear more about that. So getting the reader thinking about your audience, trying to get them interested in who you are and what you've done, as opposed to, here are the 18 units of project-based learning that I did. Now I know. Good, perfect. I don't need to talk to you.
What about the cutesy stuff? Pictures on the resume paper. No.
Not for me.
No. Cross the board.
I think you should. A resume stands out that is beautifully designed. A resume that's well laid out and flows really well and maybe has a few elements of design to it absolutely stands out as professional and a lot of work goes into it. A resume with clip art on it is the exact opposite. Do not put your picture. I had someone who said on their sidebar skills the internet and had a clip art of like an old desktop computer with www on the screen, and I didn't believe them that they had a skill on the internet based on that picture. So it's ridiculous. And so there's a big difference between artfully designed and laid out and clip art and craziness like that. Comic Sans font, absolutely not.
Great. Well, I think it's time for us to begin to think about heading across the street, but I want to thank our panelists so much for such frank and great answers.